Hi, this is Harold Long. Welcome to the Hiltran United Weekly Message and Podcast. I'm glad you're making time for this week's teaching. I will have more to say at the end, but for now, let's dive right in.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this morning. It's good to be back together in person, and thankfully the weather is better. The temperature is above freezing. It's all good. We welcome you who are joining us online as well. Please join us as we sing our song of gathering. We love to tell the story.
Continued through the year. So please join us, and the meeting ID is in your bulletin.
Also, we would like you to use the prayer wall on our website at www.hiltran.org/prayerwall to submit your prayer request. You can also submit your prayer request on our private Facebook group, Hiltran United. And if you don't have internet, then just please send directly to Pastor Harold. We will have a one board meeting today after the service. Join me in the call to worship. God, visit the earth with abundance.
Praise be to God for the blessings which enrich our lives.
Make us stewards of your creation, sharing the abundance.
Teach us to share and help others.
We praise you for the gifts and ask your guidance in sharing them.
Enter our hearts and fill us with the joy of sharing, for we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. We thank you, dear Lord, for faithful words that expose error and show us reality. Thank you that though we live in a dangerous world, we are kept by a faithful shepherd. Grant that we may walk close to him and not let anything take us away from that day by day, moment by moment, companionship of his presence. We ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You can give online at www.hiltran.org/online-giving. And today we're talking about following Christ's example. Good morning, Kingdom family. My name is Pam, and I'm a disciple of Jesus Christ here at church. I want to echo what all of you have been saying. It is great to be back to church at Transformation, and close to coming back to church at Hillsborough United Methodist Church. And for those of you watching from home because of safety reasons or other concerns, this message is for you as well. For us to provide the weekend services that we do, it takes countless volunteers. I do not know where we would be if it weren't for these beautiful people who so willingly give up their time to serve the Lord and serve you each week. To watch online, it takes our worship and tech team to make that a reality. For those here in person, it now takes the parking lot team, host team, a group of people who diligently clean our restrooms, the team who sterilizes the sanctuary between services, and so many more. And as our groups begin to meet again in person, a whole new group of volunteers will be re-enlisted. To all these peoples, I want to say thank you. You are the embodiment of the verse 1 John 2, 5-6, which says, "By this we may know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked." Jesus came to serve and not be served. By the level of commitment you show each week and how you are stewarding your time and talent, you truly follow Christ's example. As we prepare for our on time of giving this morning, stewardship is not just treasure, it is also time, talent, and touch. Our volunteers are great stewards of these things, and we are the beneficiaries. Let us now be equally great stewards with our treasure. Once again, we will all be the beneficiaries, but so will those in our community. The students and teachers.
Hi again, this is Harold. Thanks for listening to our weekly message and podcast. I hope that we have shared something helpful to you wherever you are in your spiritual journey. Just so you know a little bit more about us, we are Hiltran United. Hiltran United is an alliance between Hillsborough United Methodist Church and Transformation United Methodist Church. We are kingdom churches and kingdom communities for people who aren't into church. We meet Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. at Hillsborough United Methodist Church and 11 a.m. at Transformation United Methodist Church. Both churches are located in the northeastern tip of the beautiful Ozark Mountains, located in Jefferson County, Missouri. We also meet during the week in smaller groups that we call life groups and home churches, and that's how we make it relational. We hear regularly from people from all over who are engaging in personal and group studies based on our teaching, and we would love to know if that is happening where you are at. If you want to connect with us, you can find us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Vimeo, and YouTube, or you can download our app from your favorite app store. Just search for the app titled Our Church by Church Dev and enter in Hiltran United, and you can access all of our available audio, video teachings, plus through the app. and or our website, you can download our PowerPoint slides, bulletin, sermon notes, and discuss the questions. It's all there for you. And lastly, if you want to learn more about how you can support Hillsboro United Methodist Church or Transformation United Methodist Church financially, please go to www.hilltran.org for more information and to give. We appreciate anything you can do to help. Hey, thanks for being a member of this extended church family. I'm glad we are in this together as kingdom people, commencing shoulder to shoulder to help people rediscover life and experience the kingdom of God.
Us just as we are. We don't have to try and get perfect in our minds before we come, because if that was the case, there would be nobody in church. Wherever you've been, come broken hearted, let
always, we can come as we are. God is ready to meet us wherever we are.
Amen.
Our scripture reading today comes from 2 Corinthians 11, 10 through 15 of the New International Version. As truly as the truth of Christ is in me, nobody in the regions of Achaia will stop this boasting of mine. Why? Because I do not love you? God knows I do. And I will keep on doing what I am doing in order to cut the ground from under those who want an opportunity to be considered equal with us in the things they boast about. For such people are false apostles, deceitful workers, masquerading as apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. It is not surprising then if his servants also masquerade as servants of righteousness. Their end will be what their actions deserve. May God bless your hearing, understanding, and application of Scripture today. Thanks be to God.
We live in an interactive world where new social media challenges pop up all the time. Some for enjoyment, some for a good cause, others are just plain dangerous. What if you tried a new challenge? One that could transform your life, community, and the world. What if you spent 40 days studying Jesus' words and applying his teachings to everyday life, all focused on five principles: being, forgiving, serving, giving, and going like Christ. So what are you waiting for? Let's join together and take the Red Letter Challenge.
Well, good morning, friend.
Good morning.
Great to see everybody. Can I get a witness on the weather? Amen.
Amen.
That's right. Compared to last week, ain't too often we have to call off church, but last week was one of those times. It was pretty brutal out, but I want to welcome everybody here. We need to continue to pay for those who are without power, because there's a few people still in our country without power due to the storm. And my daughter was without power for a long time down in Houston. You know, she just got it back a couple days ago, and they're still boiling their water. So prayer for clean water and a better experience than they're having. I don't watch a lot of news, but I watched the extended version of Glenn Zimmerman, the meteorologist, giving his long-term forecast for now until spring. Unfortunately, he said that they're predicting still a lot of cold weather and potential for a pretty snowy March. So, boo.
Yeah,
right. I get away. This morning, we start our Lent message series called the Red Letter Challenge. And you've been hearing a lot about that through emails and videos and just talking about it. But we also have a 40-day challenge to go along with it. Right here it is. It's called the Red Letter Challenge book. And if you don't have that, I encourage you to get that. Just go to redletterchallenge.com or your favorite online vendor and order that book, because it's a powerful 40-day discipleship. We're in day five, which is really the first 5 days of just laying out the content of this. And so we've been doing that over the past 5 days through video messages, through our email program, but also through our Facebook pages as well. But it's a powerful challenge, and tomorrow really starts the work. Tomorrow starts the application of this, and we'll be doing this sermon series that'll go right along with it, and that's what we're going to be talking about today. But if we do this as a collective group of people, I don't know if you've ever been through discipleship classes or really been discipled in your Christian walk. So many people have. They've come to church, they got saved, they went through a few things, but they've never really been discipled. And this journey will take you on a discipleship journey. I promise you, you will not be the same after 40 days of living into this study. So wherever you're at, even if you haven't gotten it yet or you're falling behind, just you can go back to our YouTube channel or our private Facebook group and watch those videos. They're only like 4 to 6 minutes each to bring us up to speed. And then boom, we launch into this series. So today is message one of this series, set up the entire week. And this series today is called Being. And we're going to be in 2 Corinthians 11, verses 10 through 15 is really what we'll be highlighting today. But everybody has a story. This will be our first slide that you'll see here today. We all have a story. You have your story, how you come along in life. And you've had some stories where you've been challenged, where you've really persevered, you tried hard, you got out the gate, and you started really fast, but you just couldn't finish for whatever reason. We all have those stories. And I can remember when I lived here in Jefferson County when I was a kid. We just moved from Nevada. We moved to Arnold, Missouri. We lived in Starling Community Trailer Park, if you remember, knows who that is. And
In the trailer park, we had these common area grounds where you just had these big medias of grass between the roads, big enough to play football and sports on. And we had a lot of pickup games that we played down through the, you know, the time that I lived there. We played a lot of football and stuff. And I became a pretty good little sports star. I played baseball at St. David's Catholic Church. I was a pretty good ball player. Had I not met the dark side, I might have been able to go on and play professional ball. I doubt that I would ever have been able to play for the Cardinals, but I might have been able to play for the Cubs. I just hung in there. I might have been able to pull that off. But I also loved to play football, and I was decent, at least with the trailer court folks. I could play some decent ball, catch, pass, you know, all that good stuff. So I decided that this particular summer, I was in seventh grade going on eighth grade, that I was going to go try out for the football team. Now, I had hair about as long as Monica's. I had taken a thumbtack out of my KISS poster and pierced my ear with it, so I had an earring, I had hair about as long as Monica's, I had a headband I made out of a piece of belt, I had gap teeth, I had freckles and pimples. I looked like a freaked out Howdy Doody is what I looked like. But I was cool, man. I was trying to be cool, and that was just how I was. So I walked from Starling Community Trailer Park all the way to Foxy 6 School to try out for the football team. And there was nobody that looked like me there. You know? People may have had some hair down to here, but I was by far the outcast in that group. And I weighed about half of what most people weighed. I weighed probably 145 tops, you know, 5'10" and 140 pounds. Not much off of what I am today, you know. But I went there. And of course I was outcast immediately because I just didn't look at people who were making fun of me. And I did my time. I put in the drills. I didn't make the team because I didn't have the skill set to do it. And that's when it's at that point I gave up sports. I got discouraged with it. And I gave up sports and focused on partying and doing those type of things. Later I would come to focus on God. You're welcome. You know, eventually. And I had, had I made the football team. So here's the reality. Had I made the football team, I probably would be in the NFL today, hanging out with the GOAT, still playing. You know, it's possible. You never know it. But that's, it's fun, but we all have those stories, right? And it turns out that people are pretty good at starting things, but not so good at finishing. Amen? I had my quest to play football. You know, I dominated the common ground in the trailer park. But I didn't match up. I didn't have the endurance, the stamina, or the strength to play with the big boys at Foxy 6. It just didn't happen. I didn't grow up around that. And so, you know, I just didn't make it. I got discouraged and I quit. According to John Acuff's book, he's got a book called Finish. And according to his book, 92% of people don't finish the goals or resolutions they set out for themselves. 92%. That's pretty depressing that it's that high. And maybe you can relate to that. But the problem was I was going on my own strength. But honestly, I don't have much strength to go on, amen? I just really don't. Yes, I believe that God gives us, you and me, everything we need at the right time. And He gives us natural ability. But natural ability alone isn't enough to win out all the time. If I want to be a great football player, I got to practice a lot, right? If I want to be a great singer, I need those lessons and practice and sing and train, you name it. If I want to be a great golfer, and I love to play golf, I need to work on my game. All aspects of the game, multiple aspects of the game. I got to go to the driving range and hit drivers and woods and irons and wedges. And I need to bunker, get into bunkers and practice my sand game. And I have to get on that putting green because it's all about the putting, right? Drive for go, or drive for show, putt for dough, as they would say. But you got to practice. And if you don't practice, you're not going to be very good at things. We kicked off this Red Letter Challenge last week, and just introducing this study. And then through a series of videos throughout the week to lay out the themes. And I don't want you to start out and fizzle out quickly if you're starting this journey. I hope to all of you lean into it. But I don't want you to fizzle out. I want to teach you how to not just start, but I want us to finish well in this study because it'll make a big difference in our church community. It'll make a big difference in your life. It'll make a big difference in your family life in a lot of ways. The stakes are just way too high for us. And we don't want to accept 92% failure. You know, we want people to get on, and 92% of the people just give up and not do the challenge. We said that after all that Jesus has done for us, after He lived, died, and rose from the dead, to absolve the sins of the world, which include my sins, of course, and yours, and offers me eternal life, I want to be the absolute best representation that I can for the kingdom in Jesus Christ. I just do. Not out of obligation, but I'd rather do so because I feel compelled from His grace. I had no other choice if I'm really living into that grace but to then go all out for Him. He's my Savior, He's my Lord, and I can't represent Him in the world unless I'm ready to do that. You know, I have to be discipled to do that. We identify the problem, which is that we don't represent Christ well. And if you disagree with that, just Google what non-Christians think about Christians. You'll see all kinds of stuff. I even shared that, I don't know if it's true or not, but myth that Gandhi even said at one point that I would be a Christian if I ever met him, because of all the hypocrisy a lot of times. They see him go to church on Sunday, but then they see him, how they act when they're out in town, or how they act when they're at home, or et cetera, et cetera. It's just a disconnect. And what is that all about? And so we really need to own that as far as individuals. So we want to live into that. And they describe Jesus followers not too good a way a lot of times. We also dealt with one of the major issues for us to follow Jesus. And if you haven't really looked at that, it's the red letters in the Bible. You know what I'm talking about? That's why it's called the red letter challenge. These are the words that Jesus spoke. You know the words that Jesus spoke. And out of all those words, we really come down with five themes, five targets that we want to shoot for. So let's say them together. We'll put them on the slide here. Being, forgiving, serving, giving, going. Those are going to be the five themes that we go through today. And today we're kicking off with being. So for the next 5 weeks, we're going to talk about one of these targets. And today, again, we're starting about being. And this is really, honestly, the one that everything hinges on. Why? And then you can go to the next slide, Peggy. Our doing flows from our being. So whatever you are is what's going to come out of you. Trash in, trash out. Garbage in, garbage out. What you think about most is going to come out. What you think about in your heart will come out with your tongue. It will come out in everything you do. You might fake it for a moment. That's what our scripture is leading up to. You can masquerade it for so long. But God knows your heart. Jesus knows your heart. And kingdom people are going to know your heart as well. Jesus is going to ask us to do a lot in this challenge. I can promise you, you're going to be pressed. But before we do anything, we need to understand that Jesus does not invite us into a religion. A check the box if you got the system done right. You know, it's just like check the box, you got it done. It's not a systematic thing. He invites us into a relationship. And that's our next slide. Jesus invites us into a relationship, not a religion. So we're not invited to become a Methodist. We're not invited to become a Christian. We're invited to a personal relationship. And do you have one? Honestly, what are you doing when nobody else is looking? We'll really give you an indication how you're living into that. As we embark on this challenge, I really see myself as a guide in a lot of sense. And before we go on a trip, we got to get packed. You know, we got to plan. You need to pack the right things. You look at the weather forecast. You look at your plans. You pack accordingly. So this Sunday, the one that we're on right now, is all about packing the right things so that we don't fizzle out. We want to finish this deal. And so I invite you to come along this journey. Our next slide would say this. I can't start strong on my own strength. I can start strong on my own strength, but I cannot finish strong on my own strength. You know, this is where the power of the Holy Spirit's got to really come into our life. I'd rather finish strong than start strong. The solution to finishing strong is not to rely on your own strength, but God's strength. And that happens with the first principle, our first target, which is being. We just got done watching the Super Bowl, or some of you did. I was crushed, obviously. You could probably hear me pouting all the way from here, in my house. I was heartbroken that the Chiefs lost. You know, it was the big talk. It was going to be the game, Brady versus Mahomes. It was going to be the game of the century. And it wasn't. It was a complete blowout. And it was disappointing, especially if you're a Chiefs fan. But the GOAT got it done. But the GOAT didn't do it by himself. He had a whole team around him. That defense played better than I've ever seen a defense play in the Super Bowl, at least in a long time. Maybe the Monsters of Midway at 85. They played awesome. They just annihilated the Chiefs. But Brady got a lot of the credit. He was definitely a guy, but he wasn't the reason for everything. It was a team effort. And that's the same with our church. If we're really going to be a kingdom-centered church, a kingdom-focused church that's in the community, building relationships, attracting new believers to come along this journey with us, then we have to be in this together. Hebrews 12:2 says this. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off, listen to what it's saying, everything that hinders and sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance, the race marked out for us, to fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. So a lot of people give Brady the credit because he came and he brought an element to the game. He brought leadership, he brought experience, and people put trust in that and they followed his lead. And he definitely encouraged a great team to become really great and they won the Super Bowl. And that's what Jesus' role is in our life. We can be great and have a lot of skills on our own, but we're never going to accomplish the kingdom goals that God's had in store for us without the Holy Spirit being the guide, without Jesus being our guide. So we have to lean into that in a big, big way. We are called to run our race, and we will finish our race when we keep our eyes on the author and finish of our faith. Looking at Jesus is the most productive thing that we can do. And as we look, he will lead us and guide us on our steps. And here, on several occasions throughout Scripture, I mean several, Jesus gives his disciples different ways in which they can be with Jesus. And these are ways you can be with Jesus. So let's look at some of those. One, abide in my word, be in God's word, John 8:31. Pray earnestly. How often do you pray? Not publicly, but privately. Matthew 9:38. Worship the Lord your God. Luke 4:8-12. Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest. Mark 6:31. And when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face. Matthew 6:17. And let us eat and celebrate. Luke 15:23. Remembrance. That's why we do. That's part of that language when we're doing the communion. Remembrance. Do this in memory of me. And then lastly, the Sabbath was made for mankind, humankind. Mark 2:27. These are the ways we can be with Jesus. So how many of those things are you really doing in your life? I mean, it's really, really important. All these things are organized around the theme of being with Jesus. Really important. At the root of all, Jesus wants us to be with him. He wants us to spend time with him because as his followers, Jesus is going to ask us to do a lot of stuff. We're going to be called to do a lot of stuff in the kingdom. But before you can do them, it's important to know why you're doing them and who you're doing them for. And our next slide would say this. Truly following Jesus, and I believe this, I believe truly following Jesus means both being with Jesus and doing the things asked of Jesus, each and every one of us. It's just that doing and being. Some people are better at being than doing. They like the whole idea of spending time with God, but they never really do anything. You know what I'm talking about? Let me give you this illustration, see how this sounds. But just think about this in context of your own faith. If a child come into the room and you said to the child, go clean your room. I think if you're a grandparent, a parent, or great-grandparent, you've said this a million times. Go clean your room. They're not going to come back in a couple of hours and say, hey, mom and dad, grandma and grandpa, I memorized that phrase, go clean your room. I got it memorized, right? They're not going to come back in a little while and go, hey, mom and dad, guess what? We studied, we learned the Greek. Peo kathrosseos to mafio. Yeah, that's how you would say, go clean your room in Greek. We memorized that. You'd be impressed, but it's not going to cut the mustard, right? You know what I'm saying? At this point, you'd be kind of disgusted with them. And they're not going to say, hey, my friends and I are going to go gather and study what it would look like to clean our room. You know? All these things sound great on the surface, but they don't get much done. But yet, that's what happens. Think about it. How many times you were taught to memorize Scripture, go through Bible studies. Do all these things. Sound familiar? And that's what we do with our faith, but we don't ever do anything. We talk a lot about it. We can play a good game, but it's still the same. And I've said it 1,000 times, and I'll say it 1,000 times more. There's 3 types of people who come to church. There's those who make it happen, those who watch it happen, and those who don't know what's happening at all. And I've been all 3 of those guys. I didn't know what was happening when I got here. I sure watched church happen for 3 years, at least. And then I finally got with the make it happen people, and it changed my life. And so that's what I encourage you to do. I mean, my experience of being around church for 30 plus years is most people watch it happen. That's what most people do. They just watch it happen. They come and they go, they check the box and see you later. Great people, great smiles, but they don't do much. Jesus said, why do you call me Lord and do not do what I tell you to do? Think about what that's saying. That's a question he may ask you one day. Why do you call me Jesus? Why do you call me your Lord, your master, and you don't do anything I tell you to do? You memorize all this stuff, but it's like that kid. And the room's still dirty. Words without action were never acceptable to Jesus. And faith without action is dead. Clearly, there is a time to do. Here's an illustration of my to-do list. You can pull it up there. You might not be able to see that well, but that's what I start with every day of my life. About the first 10 or 15 minutes, once I get past my morning ritual, I start with that. And I spend about 10 or 15 minutes on that to-do list. Transferring things over from yesterday, adding things I need to do, things I got to get done. Blah, 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 blah. I've been using that for years. But I am definitely a doer. I'm more a doer than I am a beer. So if I had to measure myself on doing and being with the Lord, I got some real work still to do with being with the Lord. Even though I try to be intentional about it. But that's where a lot of weaknesses are at. So taking time out of our busy lives to spend time with Jesus requires a level of faith and trust that most of us just don't always have the patience for. And in many ways, this could be more of a trust problem than anything. Here's our slide. Think about this. If we cannot trust Him in the calm of His presence, we will never be able to trust Him in the pursuit of His purpose. Are you listening? If I can't spend time one-on-one with Jesus, enough just to trust being in His presence, it's not going to spill over into the things I'm doing in my life. But if we don't spend time being with Jesus, our doing will not be productive. And if we don't spend time resting in God and learning from Him, we'll quickly burn out and our activity will become nothing more than more about us, really, than it is about Christ. We'll run a mile thinking we're ahead of everybody, then that second mile will just burn out and we'll quit. We'll just get tired and it'll go away. Psalm 46:10 says this, "Be still and know that I am God." Many of us don't know how to be. We know how to do, but we struggle with the being. Just being still. How many of us really sit and do that? And so that's a challenge we all have. Our next slide would say this. Before we do what Christ asked us to do, we need to be with Him. And so that's really, really important. This is what this whole message is about, is being with Christ. What can you do, start today, to be more intentional to be with Christ? This being really could be synonymous with spiritual disciplines. Spiritual disciplines are good habits that allow you to more closely follow Jesus if you haven't. These disciplines have been practiced for centuries by those who follow Jesus. And the healthiest way to follow Christ and seek Him first is for our doing to flow out of our being. Can you go to the next slide? Our doing flows out of who we are and who we become when we spend time with Christ. It's really the truth. Here's how I see it playing out. When I spend time with Christ, I can't wait to start doing what He says. It's really the truth. When I come to church and worship Christ, it gives me the fuel I need to keep going in life. Hopefully it does you too. When I read the Bible, it doesn't take long for it to manifest itself in me. And pretty soon it becomes like a fire, you know, that just shoots up through my bones and I get energized by it. I want to share it with as many people as I can. When I pray, there's a peace that comes over me. I can't explain it, but it just does. When I rest and remember all that He's done, you know, I have a gratitude that just flows in my heart. I've never met anybody that compromised their walk in the Lord that had gratitude in their hearts. When I fast, I learn to lean on God more in times of struggle. Remember, He's my provider. Maybe some of you are doing some fasting now as we're going through Lent. And when I'm Sabbath, when I just rest, I remember it's not about me. I'm centered on who created it all. And that was our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If you truly want to follow Jesus well, it happens in your quiet time with God. I believe that your private battles will determine your public victories. Many of us in this room would say that we want to live like Jesus, that we want to follow Him closely. And I'm sure you've noticed, but the people you spend the time around really matters. Many times, we've even started acting like them if we hang around them long enough. We start saying the same words they say and repeat the same phrases. Even if it's by accident. In fact, show me your top five people you hang out with, and I guarantee you I can tell you a lot about yourself. Matter of fact, you tell me who your friends are, I'll tell you your destiny. I can promise you. Who you're around matters. There's really three things you can do a lot. It's number one, who am I around? At these three questions, who am I around? Number two, what's it doing to me? And number three, is it okay? Because you are what you think about most. You are what you're influenced by. And so if you're hanging around a lot of non-believers that are just living worldly lives, your life's going to reflect that too. If you want to be a kingdom person, then you need to be hanging around kingdom people. Many of us say that Jesus is our number one priority. But I don't think that's our actions that show up that way many times. Because if He was your number one priority, why is it that you have such a hard time carving out time to be with God? See, I was pressed on this years ago. If He's your priority, it should not be an issue. To make time for God. You might say, well, Harold, you don't understand my life. I'm so busy. You only work one day a week, Pastor Harold. Yeah. You just don't know how tired I am, how grinding the grind is. You don't even know what that's all about. Okay, maybe it's so. Why is your number one priority God the one that gets cut first then? If God is the most important, shouldn't that be the last thing that gets cut out of your life? But usually one of the first things. Should Netflix get cut before Jesus? Should prayers be more important than social media posts? that God is more important, our top priorities. Why is it that many of us will check our Facebook posts or our social media posts before we even pray if God's a priority? Why is it that we hit our email before we hit our knee mail? Right? Really, really important. I'm starting to sound corny. I'm starting to preach. I've got to just keep going here. Right? Ladies, and I'm speaking to the ladies, isn't spending time with the one who had nails pierced more important than the ones who do your nails or getting your nails done? Think about it. And besides, and guys, you're not going to leave me hanging on this one. Guys don't care about your nails anyway. Can I get a witness? Do we really care about all that stuff? I just feel like I need to tell you this. I know I'm meddling and stuff, and I know I'm digging myself a hole, as Foghorn Leghorn would say. You're digging yourself a hole, boy. But guys don't care. I just need to tell you, ladies, that we just don't really care about your nails. You know what? I've never heard a guy in my life, and guys, can I get away, ever in my life, in any locker room, any hunting camp, anywhere, ever said, did you see the nails on that babe? Those were amazing nails. I've never heard anybody see that. Can I get a goodness? I've never heard that. And guys, should God come before hunting and fishing? I know it's convenient to leave your family and go out in nature and have a few drinks, shoot the guns. And by the way, I hate picking on this topic because I love to hunt fish, but I thought it was only fair since I picked on the nails with the ladies. But I love to hunt fish, you know. And my favorite hobby is golf, and I love it, and there's nothing wrong with it. But is God more important than golf? Our actions prove what we think about most. I'm not saying it's wrong to watch Netflix or have a social media account or get your nails done or to hunt or fish or golf or any of that. But none of them are good if they take the place of the one who should be on the throne of our heart, and that is Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Good things can become bad things when they become God things in our heart. And that's God with a little G, when they become idols. You know, we have a sin scale that we do in church sometimes, and we got these sins that we put up here on top. The church has been doing this for ages, but we got these few sins that we love to really, you know, give people a hard time about, like homosexuality and money and all this stuff. But I can promise you, the sin that's lifted up most in the Bible, thousands of times, I'm talking thousands of times, is idolatry. There's not even a close second. None of those even come close to a second. It's the number one sin in the Bible, and that's that little G stuff that we put in our life. It's the number one sin, and we're all guilty. But yet we'll take these little other things, and we'll put them up here. It's like, these are the abomination of the Christian life. And Jesus said, not so much. Your idol worship is the biggest sin in your life, I can promise you. So it's not a time issue, it's a priority issue. But people feel tired, they feel exhausted. People, they are not getting true rest. What goes out will come in. You know, it's just really to do. Come in, go out, garbage in, garbage out. You're not filling your life with things that people that ultimately can give you rest. But Jesus says this in Matthew 11:28. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. This has been an exhausting year with COVID-19, unemployment, all the stuff. I mean, I'm just burnt out on it. I know you are too. So you even had COVID. So you're just done. I watch people die. I watch people get really sick. I watch through a lot of stuff. It's just exhausting. But my rest and my peace isn't going to come from investing in these things, these worldly things. It's going to come through being with Christ. Why is being with Him so important? Because when we be with Christ, our doing is so much more effective. When I'm supercharged, my batteries are charged because I'm living with Christ. I got the Holy Spirit alive in my life. I'm going to be way more effective in the kingdom than with not. We're going to talk a lot about doing a lot for Him in this message series. That's part of being a disciple. But the more you're with Christ, the more you'll understand what He's done for you, and the more you can't help but want to do things for Him. And that's just really the truth. The more I've lived into this kingdom calling, the more I want to be in the kingdom. So here's what I'm asking you to do. Prioritize Jesus in your life. Okay, well, how do you do that? You find ways to be near Jesus, to lean on Jesus. Well, sit at His feet. But Harold, how do you do that? He's not here today. What do you mean? What can we do? Well, here's a lot of things we can do right now. You can come to church on a regular basis. Unless you're dead or on vacation or it's an emergency, be here. You're important. When you're not here, church is not the same, I can promise you. You may feel like you're only this big and your really life don't really matter. I'm telling you, when you're not here, it affects everybody. Period. And you miss out. We miss out. The blessing is gone because you're not here. Read the Bible. No Bible, no breakfast. No Bible, no coffee. Whatever you got in some of your life now. Come on. No We looking at no coffee, gotta have the coffee. Sorry, but then we talk about the coffee. But you know what I'm saying, make it a priority, get into God's Word. Get into a home group. Maybe you've never been a part of a small group or a life group or a home church or whatever you want to call it, but I encourage you to start one. Even if it's a virtual group where you're just meeting virtually, and do that consistently. It'll make a big difference in your life because as the church grows, you know, it's going to be hard to have personal relationships with all the people that are in your life. So this having this small accountability group that know everything about you, you know everything about them, you're breaking bread together, it's powerful. That's a great way to live into this kingdom calling and be with Jesus. Pray. How often do you pray? Really, I mean sincerely. I mean pray on your own, not just coming to church and community prayer. I'm talking about on your own. You really live in and spend time praying. Listen to worship music. This is something I challenged Monica and Crystal at HUMC to start doing in the future here, is to give us a praise list every week, a playlist. Here's five or six songs that are on the playlist. So when you're listening to them through the week, you know other brothers and sisters in your church, kingdom community, are doing the same thing. It adds a little bit of fire to that. It gives you a little bit of inspiration. You can almost see everybody's voices and their hands singing these songs as you're singing. Schedule a 2-day to 3-day retreat every year. Some of you go to Emmaus. If you've never been to a walk to Emmaus, go. I can promise you it'll change your life, men and women. Go back and serve if you've already been. Lots of different retreats out there. I go to a thing called Men's Encounter. They're still having because of COVID, but I haven't went. We usually have about 4 or 5 retreats a year. Hope to take some of you guys with us when we go. It's in Lebanon, Missouri. We'll have anywhere from 500 to 700, 800 guys there for the weekend. A lot of them are coming to Christ for the first time. Probably 40, 50 baptisms done that week. It's a powerful, powerful experience. I do lots of stuff like that throughout the year. I encourage you to do the same thing. It'll make a big difference in your life and really plug you in. If you don't do these things I mentioned above, then there's other ways you can spend time with Jesus as well. You will have to prioritize Jesus in your schedule. And you'll have to find rest, just like he said. You will not be able to start, but you won't be able to finish. Isaiah, the book of Isaiah says this. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on the wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. God did not send you. He did not send me. He did not start the church only to see us fall short and give up. He sent us to finish what he started, which is to help restore the kingdom of God here on earth as it is in heaven. God will complete what he started. Whatever God starts, he finishes. Amen?
Amen.
This time I want to invite the band back up. Friends, I'm just going to go ahead and invite you to stand as we close out here and enter into prayer. We may start some things and not finish, but God starts what he finishes. Amen.
Amen.
Philippians 1:6 says, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Our God is a finisher. He finished by giving it everything he had. He gave it all so that we can give it all. Is there any worthier cause than going after Jesus? I hope not. If he started you in a new relationship with him, he's going to give you enough grace. And he will give you enough grace to see it through to the end, I can promise you. If he started you in a marriage, he will give you the strength, reconciliation, and forgiveness needed to bring that marriage to fruition. We have a lot of long-term marriages here. It's beautiful. If he has blessed you with children, he will give you the direction, the purpose, and the vision for raising those kids in a kingdom-like manner. If he has started you in recovery, we know we have a lot of people that have plenty of hurts, habits, and hang-ups. Some serious issues going on. He will give you the power needed to combat the temptations of this world. If he started you in a church to reach a city, which I believe transformation was put here for a reason, he will give us the power and the people and the resources to make that happen. Amen? You got to believe that, friends. I mean, you just got to live into that. If he's started a movement where people put his words into practice and change the picture we are representing of him, he will give us the strength to finish. Are you listening? I mean, it's really, really important. God is a God that finishes us, no matter what happens. They tried stopping Jesus. They put him on a cross. They nailed him there. They buried him in a tomb. You are not done. You are finished. This is what they said to Jesus. And God said, no, no, no. Amen, right? I'm not done yet. You didn't get to tell me when I'm finished. I finished this on my own strength. And he rose from the dead. He defeated sin. He defeated death. Amen. He defeated the devil. And now he walks with us in redeeming ourselves and restoring the world with him. We can do this, friends, can't we?
Amen.
Come on, let's do it. I mean, that's what this leadership team's about. This is what our church is about, is to build this kingdom. And we've been challenged because of a lot of things. But we can't change those things. We can't change COVID-19. We can't change what happened in the past. We can't change all that stuff. All we can do is live it today. Today's all we got. But if we do that with a kingdom mindset as disciples, we can do amazing things together, friends. I'm telling you, we can do it. So let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this time today. We thank you for the red letter challenge and the challenge that it puts on each and every one of our souls, each and every one of our lives. Lord, we need help being with you. We need help being in presence with you, in private with you. So Lord, this week we as kingdom people, we're praying for the courage, the humility, and the willingness to be with you. And that is our aim. That is our focus. That's where we're going to really put everything we have into. Lord, so we just pray for the Holy Spirit to inspire each and every one of us to live into this kingdom calling of being with you. Because if we're not good at being with you, we're not going to be good doing for you. And we want to be great doers, but we only can do that if we're with you. So we just pray for the Holy Spirit to guide us in that venture. It's in your Son's name we pray these things. Amen.
Amen.
Please join us as we sing How Great Is Our God.
The splendor of the King.
16 through 18. It's one of my favorite scriptures. It says, "Be joyful always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus." And I would also add, love God and love people. Just take that with you as we go out today and sing our final song, Happy Day.
Trying to do this and pick this up, and then I was lost.
I don't think anybody missed me.
something happen?
I don't know.